Hi everyone, in this video we'll start with doing an unboxing of your Arduino kit. Let's get started. So let's start off with this device. This is called a solderless breadboard, and the way it works is that there's conductors underneath these holes that run either horizontally or vertically, and it allows you to connect different points to other points. So, for example, you see that there's a plus and a red line, and it's actually a minus and a blue line. There's a conductor which runs underneath all of these holes horizontally, and it connects all of these holes together. And this is a separate conductor here, going all the way across horizontally. So the idea is that you take the plus 5 volts from your Arduino and stick it in one of these holes, and then you've got plus 5 at all of these places, depending on how you actually want to use your jumpers. You would connect the ground pin from your Arduino to this blue set of holes, and then you've got ground accessible anywhere. You could connect this one to this one, and then you've got plus from for all of these, this line and this line. These are arranged vertically, so I've got a set of 5 that are all connected, then this next set of 5, they're connected, and so on. And this allows you to do things like this. Take a chip and I'll push it in there. And then I have access to this particular pin using these 4 holes. So it gives me lots of options to jumper signals here, there, and everywhere on the breadboard. There are these tabs here. If you've got multiple boards, you can connect them together and get a larger surface. But for what you're doing in terms of learning the Arduino system and doing simple projects, this should be plenty big for you. There's also a ribbon cable which has jumpers, male and female. So you could connect the female end to some device that's either in the kit or something that you buy separately. And then this could either be connected to the breadboard or directly to the Arduino Uno. We've got some various resistors. These resistors, they come in, I guess, strips. That's the best way to put it. So, this set, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 100 ohm resistors. So 100 ohm resistor, 100 ohms isn't a lot. The usually you're using 10K or 10,000 ohms or 1,000 ohms. Resistors go from anywhere from 0.1 to 20 million ohms. But the range that you would normally use, 10K or 1K resistors, for digital purposes, that's pretty much all you're going to really need. But on occasion, you'll need some bigger and smaller ones, and they're here for you if you need them. These are contact switches, momentary contact switches. So they're normally off when you press down. You press down, they connect up. I'm not sure whether the connection is between these two points or between these two points. These also have to be, you have to be really careful when you put these in. If you put them into the breadboard, they're a little bit too wide for the breadboard and they're not straight. So, you know, this may be a bit of a problem. One thing that I do is I get a pair of needle nose pliers and I'll rotate, I'll straighten the contacts and then I'll rotate them 90 degrees and that allows me to push them into the breadboard. Without damaging the breadboard itself. There, that goes in there. And they've helpfully included some things so that they don't hurt your little fingers when you press them. And when you remove things, I have something I just picked up at a restaurant. Just a piece of wood, bamboo, helps pry things out of the breadboard so that you don't ruin things. We have some LED displays. This one is a dot matrix or matrix of, let's see, is that 8? 8 by 8. 8 times 8 is 64. You've got 64 different LED points that you can illuminate. I think they're red. I have to try them out sometime. You need to make this work. You actually need a chip that will translate a few wires from the Arduino to allow you to access all of these pins. For all of these LEDs. Some seven-segment devices. This is a one-digit, seven-segment device. Each one of these is a separate LED, which will turn on depending on how you have wired up and how you power these pins. Seven segments because there are seven, but then there's the decimal point, which may or may not actually be connected to an LED. This would make it 8 LEDs. But they're still called 7 segments. Here's a 4-digit display. I've already opened this up, as you can see, it's probably obvious, but this is the Arduino. This version of Arduino is called Uno. I've used what was called a 2009. Do I have it here? Let's see. This is about 5 years old. This is one of the original Arduinos. You can see the difference between the two. Not that much of a difference. They look pretty similar, apart from the branding and the name. There are some differences, though. But in actual practice, these are interchangeable. There's when you actually load the programs onto the Arduinos, the compilation is different. The compiling sequence is a little bit different for the Arduino Due Milanova and the Arduino Uno, but you just set that in the integrated development environment that I'm going to show you in a few minutes. So this is the old one. This is the new one. This is maybe a design that's a year and a half old or so. This is the actual microcontroller chip. It's made by a company in Norway called Atmega. Sorry, Atmel. The chip is the Atmega 328. Is that right? The Atmega 328 PU. You can actually buy these chips on eBay. They cost about $3 each, roughly. The Uno itself, you can get these from China on eBay or AliExpress or Deal Extreme. They're around 10 bucks or so. This is the USB connector. You see that there's kind of a squarish connector here. This is for an external power supply, DC power supply. You could hook up a 9-volt battery in this, and then that 9-volt battery, 9 volts is regulated down to 5 volts by this regulator here. This is a reset button. Press it and it resets the entire system. So if you get locked in any kind of an evil loop, this will get you out of it. The pins are that you use to control the device. So you add sensors and actuators. You use these pins here, and they're connected to what are called headers. And the headers here are here for two reasons. First one is that you want to be able to connect up. You haven't seen these yet, but these are jumper cables. You want to be able to insert these and connect the pins on the Arduino to the breadboard. But the other reason is that when the Arduino people first developed this idea, they wanted to make it easy for people to add different boards to for different functions. For example, if I want to don't want to have a battery, I want a battery, but I want it to be solar powered. I want it to be recharged by the sun. You could create what's called a shield, and the shield would actually sit on top of the Arduino unit. So this is a solar charger shield, and it just inserts, sits on top of the Arduino Uno. And with this, I can connect the solar panel here and the lithium power pack here. And this would allow me to charge up the power pack, and then once the power pack gets fully charged, it then stops the charging. So it doesn't cause overheating or fire. I can put more shields on. I can have more than one shield. If I wanted to have a solar charger, but I also wanted to connect it to the internet, I can add an Ethernet shield. So the Ethernet cable goes in here, and let's see if I can do this elegantly. pins are a little bit longer here because we need to have extra space here because of the USB. So this is now sitting firmly on. And so this little pack allows me to charge and connect up a lithium battery and also connect up to the to Ethernet. I could also, rather than wired Ethernet, I could put a Wi-Fi shield, but I don't have one here, so let's take this apart. We'll get further into how to actually break out the connector pins to the Arduino, to the breadboard. We'll do this in another video. So that's the Uno. And I pulled this out of the side. This is the 9-volt battery connector. And presumably you would do that and connect this up to a 9-volt battery. There's a handy, very short USB connector. USB connector does two things. It supplies 5-volt power to the Arduino, and it also provides a connection from the from your computer, from the integrated development environment, the Arduino IDE, and your Uno. So you plug in the squarish one into the Arduino, and this, of course, goes into your computer. The IDE is available for Macintosh, Windows, and Linux. You can get it from arduino.cc. CC being, it's not Creative Cloud. Here we have an LCD display. This is what's known as a 16x2, which means that there are 16 characters across and two lines. So you can't put a tweet on this. There aren't enough characters for it. But you could have some very informative indicators in English or whatever language you want. The device connects up to 4 pins to the Arduino. This is kind of a cool thing. Up until I got the kit, I'd never actually played with this. This is a near-field radio frequency receiver. Near-field radio frequency is basically what you use when you have a key card to get into the North Block. This uses the MIFARE classic protocol. It's not the same as the key card protocol that you use to get into the school. I've already checked. Go ahead and try, but the school cards cannot be read by this. This is kind of the cheapest, oldest protocol for near field RF. The kit comes with a key card and a key fob. So that should be fun. We may have an interesting project for you later on in the semester that deals with near-field communication devices. Okay. this is a servo motor. Servo motors work let's add this. Servo motors don't turn fully 360 degrees, or if some of them turn 360, it's just that. They don't go around and keep turning. They will turn from 0 to 360 and back, and you can tell the servo what angle you want it to turn to. You can get some, you can get very good control with this. Back when my father was playing with radio-controlled model airplanes, he used servos to control things like the throttle of the engine and the rudders. So presumably what you would do is connect this to a rod, which would go to a rudder, and as it moves back and forth, it would make the rudder go back and forth. What else do we have? Here's another motor. This is a different kind of motor. This one has a gear in it. So when the motor turns, the motor's turning very, very fast, but it gears down and the actual shaft turns very, very slowly. This is known as a stepper motor. So this stepper motors are used in things like scanners and printers. 3D printers use them. So every axis of movement has its own stepper motor, and the stepper motor allows you to move things very, very finely back and forth, geared things, or rotate things very precisely. This is a 5-volt DC motor, so it's built to be worked on, connected to the Arduino 5-volt system. These are jumper cables for your breadboard. They come in three different lengths, short, medium, and long. This is a water level sensor. I'm not sure if it's a water level sensor or if it's a moisture sensor. I'm not really sure. I presume you just stick this in water or in, say, soil, and you can tell whether your plants need water. I'm assuming. I'll have to try that out sometime. What's this? This is a motor driver module. So you've got your motor here, and you plug it into the module, and you connect these four pins to the Arduino. Now, some of these things require external libraries that you have to load into the IDE to get these things to actually run. Most of these items require libraries, but the libraries are easy to find and they're easy to manage in the Arduino IDE. This is a real-time clock module. If you put a little battery in here, and then connect it to Arduino, you can tell it what second, what minute, hour, day, week, month, year. And whether or not it's powered, it doesn't matter because the battery, the little battery that you put in here keeps the clock running at a very, very low current. So you can have this running without power for years. This is a keypad. 4x4, 16 different keys. This is a joystick. Joystick has two axes of movement, up and down, and side by side, side to side. Also, if you press, there's a micro switch here which gives you perhaps an on-off. This is the works. This is a temperature and humidity sensor. It's not terribly accurate, but it's useful. This is an RGB module. This allows you to connect the Arduino and then program it to give you different colors at different times. This is something that, if you want to control a device like a radio or something that you plug into the house wall power, you can't do it directly with the Arduino. It would be very dangerous to just plug the thing into the wall socket and hope things would work for you. Not only dangerous, it would blow up the Arduino. What you need to do is you need to provide isolation between the household current and the Arduino, and the relay is one way of doing that. So the commands from the Arduino come in on these three pins, and you would connect the plus, minus, and ground to these contacts, and it would allow you to turn on and off various devices. This is meant to work with 5 volts DC from the Arduino, and it says that it can handle 10 amps at 120 volts AC. That's roughly, to be conservative, that would allow switching of a 1,000 watt device. So a very small heater could be used, or a small refrigerator. You use this to under Arduino control. This is what's known colloquially as volume control. This is a 10K resistor, variable resistor. This is a microphone or sound sensor. You turn this to set the sensitivity. This is the microphone here. So I've got this. It looks like a cheap Chinese channel remote, TV remote, but it's actually something that you can use . Here are some other resistors, 1K, 10K, and 220 ohm resistors. Let's get back to this remote. So I've got two devices here. This is an infrared receiver, and this allows you, once you put a battery in here, you can send pulses, infrared pulses, depending on how you press the buttons. that can be received by the receiver and then read by the Arduino device. So you can use this to control your Arduino through infrared. Also have a flame sensor. Now, I've never actually used one of these. It looks like an LED, and there must be some instruction somewhere on the web or on YouTube to show how to actually hook this up and make it work with Arduino. Got a couple of buzzers here. Some LEDs, some yellow ones, some green ones, red ones. We have a couple of tilt sensors. They used to have a little ball of lead, sorry, not lead, mercury in them. But these have just a little metal ball in them. So you move it in one direction, the switch is open, you move it like this, and the switch closes. We've got some light-dependent sensors. These are change their resistance according to how much light falls on them. Got three of them here. This is an LM35. I think this is a temperature sensor. I'm not exactly sure, but I think it is a temperature sensor. And then this is, if I can look at the list here, on the back of the kit, this is a 74HC595. And this, I think, is used to drive this little device here. Right, so we'll put this away, and then we'll connect up our Arduino and see if we can get, see if we can get a very simple sketch to run on our brand new Uno. Well, one thing I should mention, you know, a lot of these circuits, this particular chip is not static sensitive, but there are a lot that are, and for that reason, they're packaged often in this kind of mirrored plastic. This is actually conductive plastic bag. So if something comes in a conductive plastic bag, that's an indicator that the pins, some of the pins are static sensitive, which means that static electricity can zap the internal components of the device and render it no longer operable. So you want to when you put these things back, you want to put them back inside their static, anti-static bag. So, careful not to crush any of these things. You know, if you break it, you can always get replacements. But if you get a replacement from China, you have to be prepared to wait 6 weeks in general. Sometimes longer. Sometimes they don't appear at all. All right. close the case on that. And I'll be right back. All right, so I've connected up the Arduino, and you should be able to see it here. And we're going to open the Arduino IDE, assuming that you have already loaded your copy in. It comes up as Arduino app in the Macintosh realm. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that the Arduino is connected up to the IDE. The IDE stands for Integrated Development Environment. You could just say the Arduino system. So the first thing under Tools is to make sure that the board is connected through USB. And it is selected here. There are a lot of other different flavors of Arduino. The Uno is the one that you have, so this should be checked. Then the port. So depending on your machine, this may look different. Particularly on Windows, this might look different. I have different ports that are available to me here. The one that I need to connect is the Arduino Uno. Other ones, you know, you'll connect it and it won't do anything. So we're now should be ready to write and upload our first sketch. And to do that, you would go into, say, examples. And in examples, there are lots of built-in examples that you can use that will show you how to do various things with your Arduino. Under basics, there is one called bare minimum, which is just a setup and then a loop. This actually does nothing. It just has the empty enclosures, the two containers that you need in a working program to actually work. So you have a setup, which are things that happen when the Arduino is powered up before it actually runs the main part of the program, which is called the loop. So within the loop, you put all of the commands that you want your Arduino to perform in its program. Now, I previously, when I had run the Arduino IDE, I had the blink sketch open, and then I closed it. And when you reopen Arduino, when you restart Arduino, it will always open the last sketch you had before you quit. So with this, this is one of the examples, basic blink, and all this does is turns an LED on for 1 second and then off for 1 second repeatedly. So most Arduinos have an onboard LED that you can control. On the Uno, it is attached to digital pin 13. And we can take a look at this once we upload this little program. You can see here that there's a slash and an asterisk. Is that an asterisk? Yeah. This is the comment command. So anything that's enclosed within between this and this is a comment. It's actually not compiled by the system when it outputs to the Arduino. This is a comment as well. So if you want a multi-line comment, you use the slash asterisk. If you have a single line comment, you just use two slashes. So the setup function runs once you press reset or power the board. The setup is just to tell the controller, I want to configure pin 13 to act as an output. You could also configure it as an input, but you can't make it be input and output at the same time. You can, in your program, switch and say, I want the pin to be an input, and then I want it to be an output. But in the setup, you set it as an output, and presumably it will stay as an output as long as there's power connected to the device. The next thing is the loop, and the loop just starts in the first line, executes first, second, third, fourth, and then executes first, second, third, fourth in a loop. So all this does is it says write digital to pin 13 high, which is 5 volts. So send 5 volts to pin 13, which happens to be connected to an LED on the board. Then delay 1,000 milliseconds, or 1 second. Then write low, or 0 volts, to the LED, which is attached to pin 13. Then wait another second. When you're done that, go to the beginning of the loop and proceed. If there are no errors in this, it should compile and then upload to the device. So I'm connected. I know I'm connected because I've checked the board and the port. And this button here allows me to verify the program. I'm going to verify it. I know there's no problems with it because it comes with the IDE, so it's presumably it's correct. Compiling the sketch, progress bar. Down here it says it's done compiling. The sketch uses 1,066 bytes, 3% of program storage space. So this is a very small program. I've got 32K of program space, which is quite a bit for a very small single chip controller. If I want to upload, the upload typically compiles and then uploads it. If I've already done a verify, it will probably not compile it unless I've made a change to the code. It should just go ahead and send it. No, it actually compiled it and it uploaded it. So let's switch over to the camera. And let's see. The light is blinking. That little light, I'm going to put it into a little bit of shadow here. This is the light. This is always connected to pin 13 of the controller. Now, it doesn't mean that you can't use pin 13 for other things. It just means that this LED is hanging off the pin, available in case you want to look at it. But this just tells us, confirms, yes, the program has run, it is running correctly. The light is on for 1 second, off for 1 second, for a total cycle of 2 seconds. It's actually working. So I'm going to re-upload and I'm going to put my coffee cup here because I want you to be able to see the lights blinking when I re-upload that same sketch. So you saw very, very quickly our TX and RX LEDs were lighting up. This was indicating to us that, yes, the Arduino is communicating with the host computer, and it was very, very fast. It doesn't take long for 1K to be transferred to the Arduino, and we once again have the LED running. If I need to restart or reset the system, I can press this button here, the reset. It flashes a little bit and then it recommences its program. So once I've uploaded the program, all I'm doing is I'm using the USB as a power supply. I don't actually need to keep this connected to the computer. If I wanted to, I could connect up a separate power source and disconnect the USB cable, and this would run automatically. So that's the first program, the first sketch on your Arduino, and in further videos, we'll take a look at some of the modules, some of the sensors and actuators, and look at theory, electrical theory, because you'll need to know a little bit about electricity so that you don't blow up your modules or blow up your Arduino. And when I say blow up, I just mean it won't blow up in a bunch of sparks and flame. It would probably just stop working because you put too much voltage into something. So, till next time, see you later.